others can benefit from it. Okay. The topic that I have chosen is the absolute and transcendental nature of Lord Ramacandra. So what I will do is I'm going to read out from and speak on Srimad-Bhagavatam, 5th canto, chapter 19. A description of the island of Jambudvipa, the first 8 verses. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Sri Shuka Uvacha. Kim Purushe Varshe Bhagavantam Adipurusham Lakshmanakracham Sitabhiramam Ramam Tacharana Sannikarsha Abhirata Paramabhagavato Hanuman Saha Kim Purushai Ravirata Bhaktir Vapaste. Srila Shukadeva Goswami said, my dear king, in Kim Purusha Varsha, the great devotee Hanuman is always engaged with the inhabitants of that land in transcendental service to Lord Ramachandra, the elder brother of Lakshmana and dear husband of Sita Devi. So, the meaning derived from the synonyms, Sri Shukadeva Goswami continued to speak. The great devotee celebrated throughout the universe, His Grace Hanumanji, who possesses continuous devotional service, worships the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the original cause of all causes, the elder brother of Lakshmana, who is very pleasing to Mother Sita, who is the husband of Sita Devi, Lord Ramachandra. He worships him with the inhabitants of the tract of land known as Kim Purusha. Hanuman is also described as one always engaged in service at the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra. Okay, text 2. Ashtishenena saha gandharvai ranugiyamana paramakalyanin bhartri bhagavat katham sam upashranoti swayam chedam gayati. A host of Gandharvas is always engaged in chanting the glories of Lord Ramachandra. That chanting is always extremely auspicious. Hanumanji and Arshtishena, the chief person in Kim Purusha worship, constantly hear those glories with complete attention. Hanuman chants the following mantras. In the Puranas, there are 2 different opinions concerning Lord Ramachandra. In the Lagu Bhagavatamrita 5.34-36, this is in the first part of Lagu Bhagavatamrita. This is confirmed in the description of the incarnation of Manu. Vasudevadi Rupana Avatara Ketita Vishnu Dharma Tare Rama Lakshmana Dhyah Kramat Ami Padmetu Ramo Bhagavan Narayana Itiritaha Sheshas Chakram Chak Sankhas Sankhascha Kramat Syur Lakshmana Dayah Madhya Desha Stita Yodhya Puresya Pasatis Smrita Mahavaikuntha Lokecha Raghavendrasya Kirtita. The Vishnu Dharmottara describes that Lord Ramachandra and his brothers Lakshmana, Bharata and Shatrughna are incarnations of Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Pradyumna and Aniruddha respectively. The Padma Purana, however, says that Lord Ramachandra is an incarnation of Narayana, and that the other 3 brothers are incarnations of Shesha, Chakra and Shankha. Therefore, Srila Baladeva Vidyabhushan has concluded, Tadidam Kalpa Bhedena Eva Sambhavya. In other words, these opinions are not contradictory. In some millenniums, Lord Ramachandra and his brothers appear as incarnations of Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Pradyumna and Aniruddha. And in other millenniums, they appear as incarnations of Narayana, Shesha, Chakra and Shankha. The residence of Lord Ramachandra on this planet is Ayodhya. Ayodhya city is still existing in the district of Faizabad. which is situated on the northern side of Uttar Pradesh. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Uttapata Kamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamstha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagana Raghunathamutam Tamsa Jeevam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Patam Sagana Anita Shri Vishakamitam Ramadhi Murti Shukalani Yumena Tishtan Anavataram Akrodhvaneshu Kintu Krishna Swayam Samabhavat Paramahkuman Yoga Vindamadhi Purushantamaham Vijami. Okay, so regarding Lord Ram, he is a Kalpavata. He appears in every day of Brahma. This is pointed out by Rupa Goswami in Laghu Bhagavatamrita. There are certain incarnations of the Lord who appear on a daily basis, meaning daily referring to Lord Brahma's day, once in a day of Brahma. Krishna himself appears once in a day of Brahma. Ramachandra also appears once in a day of Brahma. So, as he appears every day, sometimes he engages in different types of pastimes. As Prabhupada's astrologer disciple Shamsundar Prabhu, once he explained this to me, he said, your grandmother, when she cooks dosas, it doesn't come out every day the same way. So like that, every day Rama is doing different things, every day by the calculation of Lord Brahma. So he does different things. So sometimes the Supreme Lord Vasudev, Sankarshan, Pradyumna, Niruddha, in these four forms, he appears. Sometimes Narayana, Shesha, Chakra and Shankha, they appear as Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna. So these are part of the varieties of spiritual existence. Okay, then text 3. Om Namo Bhagavate Uttama Shlokaya Nama Arya Lakshana Shila Vrataya Nama Upashikshatatmana Upasita Lokaya Nama Sadhu Vadan Nikashanaya Namo Brahmanya Devaya Mahapurushaya Maharajaya Nama Iti. Let me please your lordship by chanting the Bija Mantra Omkar. I wish to offer my respectful obeisances unto the personality of Godhead, who is the best among the most highly elevated personalities. Your lordship is a reservoir of all the good qualities of Aryans, people who are advanced. Your character and behavior are always consistent, and you always control your senses and mind. Acting just like an ordinary human being, you exhibit exemplary character to teach others how to behave. There is a touchstone that can be used to examine the quality of gold, but you are like a touchstone that can verify all good qualities. You are worshipped by Brahmanas, who are the foremost of all devotees. You, the Supreme Person, are the King of Kings, and therefore I offer my respectful obeisances unto you. So Lord Ramachandra has been described by Sri Hanumanji here as the best among the most highly elevated personalities. In each form of the Supreme Lord, he exhibits a certain mood, a certain character. For instance, when he appears as Krishna, he exhibits his various pastimes, and therefore Krishna, Swayam Bhagavan Krishna, is referred to as Leela Purushottam, the sportive Supreme Person. Whereas Lord Rama, he is Maryada Purushottam. He comes to establish and demonstrate the various limits of behavior, the various rules and regulations of Vedic Dharma very, very strictly. Therefore, Hanuman says, your lordship is the reservoir of all the good qualities of Aryans, people who are advanced. So the Supreme Lord exhibits all these good qualities of Aryans. Arya, this is not a racial expression at all. Arya refers to a person who is noble by character, a person who is aware of the importance of liberation. Prabhupada explains in his commentary to the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita that Arya, the expression Arya refers to that person who knows the value of liberation, who is interested in attaining liberation, while accepting Vedic authority. So Lord Ramachandra, he exhibits all the good qualities of the Aryas. His character and behavior are always consistent also. Ramodvir nabhibhashate, Rama doesn't speak twice, means that he doesn't say something and he doesn't need to say the same thing again to confirm that he meant what he meant. This is a statement of Lord Ram himself. It also means that he doesn't say something and then later say, no, actually I meant that. What he says is what he says. Very much predictable. And therefore, he's very much dear to all those who accept Vedic authority, not just those who are pure Vaishnavas. You always control your senses and mind. Lord Rama, he exhibits this throughout the Ramayana, Valmiki Ramayana, you'll see this. Acting just like an ordinary human being, you exhibit exemplary character to teach others how to behave. So this is Lord Ram's main reason. According to the teachings of Sri Ramanuja, as passed down in his disciplic succession, Lord Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, they came to demonstrate four aspects of Vedic Dharma. Lord Rama came to exhibit the Dharma, demonstrate the Dharma, or ordinary Dharma, the Dharma of being obedient to one's father within the boundaries of Vedic Dharma and so on. Lakshmana demonstrates the Dharma of devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Bharata and Shatrughna, Bharata, he comes to demonstrate the Dharma of being dependent on the Supreme Lord, which is a technical way of saying that he demonstrates the Dharma of carrying out the instructions of the Supreme Lord. Lakshmana teaches the Dharma of serving the Supreme Lord, being with the Supreme Lord and serving him. Bharata, he demonstrates the Dharma of carrying out the instructions of the Supreme Lord, even if Lord Rama orders him to be externally away from him. Then Shatrughna, he teaches a Dharma of being a pure servant of a pure devotee of the Supreme Lord. So these are four aspects of Vedic Dharma which are actually required for each and every one of us. And by Lord Ram's will, he teaches others how to behave. And his expansions, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, they also teach how to behave. Lord Ram is also considered to be a touchstone that can verify all good qualities. In other words, one can understand the extent to which one is himself pure by comparing his alleged purity with the purity exhibited by Ram. Ram is also worshipped by Brahmanas, who are the foremost of all devotees. He is the king of all kings. Yattad vishuddha anubhava matram ekam svateja sadhvasta gunam vyavastham pratyak prashantam sudhiyopalam bhanam hyanam arupam niraham prapadye. The Lord whose pure form, Satchidananda Vigraham, is uncontaminated by the modes of material nature, can be perceived by pure consciousness. In the Vedanta, he is described as being one without a second. Because of his spiritual potency, he is untouched by the contamination of material nature. And because he is not subjected to material vision, he is known as transcendental. He has no material activities, nor has he a material form or name. Only in pure consciousness, Krishna consciousness, can one perceive the transcendental form of the Lord. Let us be fixed, let us be firmly fixed at the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra. Let us offer our respectful obeisances unto those transcendental lotus feet. The Vaishnava commentators, they point out that Hanuman is the ideal spiritual master. He demonstrates all the features of a full-fledged acharya. This is suggested by Valmiki himself in the fifth canto of Valmiki Ramayana, Sundara Kanda. And when we come to that point, we'll be able to read it. So here we can see Hanuman is describing Lord Rama. And we can see how he describes Lord Rama. Those who are infected with the Sahajiya mentality, they do not like to appreciate the absolute and transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord. Like here, you can clearly see how Sri Hanuman describes Ram. Basically makes the point that Lord Ram is not touched by Maya. He's not in touch with material nature. He is not engaged in any material activities. He does not have a material form, material name. Only when we come to the transcendental platform beyond the three modes of material nature, then we can perceive his spiritual name, form, qualities, pastimes, and so on. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, appears in various expansions as stated in the Brahma Samhita 539. Rama Dhimurti Shukala Niyamena Tishthannana Avataram Karod Bhuvaneshu Kintu Krishna Swayam Samabhavat Paramah Puman Yoga Govinda Madhi Purusham Tumaham Bhajami. I worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead Govinda, who is always situated in various incarnations such as Rama, Narasimha, and many sub-incarnations as well. But who is the original personality of Godhead known as Krishna and who incarnates personally also? Krishna, who is Vishnu Tattva, has expanded himself in many Vishnu forms, of which Lord Ramachandra is one. We know that the Vishnu Tattva is carried by the transcendental bird Garuda and is equipped with different types of weapons in four hands. Therefore, we may doubt whether Lord Ramachandra could be in the same category, since he was carried by Hanuman, not by Garuda, and had neither four hands, nor the Shankha Chakra, Kada, and Padma. He did not have the conch, the disc, the mace, or the lotus. Consequently, this verse clarifies that Ramachandra is as good as Krishna. Rama Adi Murti Shukala. This verse means, this verse in the Brahma Samhita that Prabhupada is quoting here. Although Krishna is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, Ramachandra is not different from him. Ramachandra is unaffected by the modes of material nature and therefore he is Prashanta, never disturbed by those modes. So this is one feature of Lord Ram that we will see in Valmiki Ramayana. He's totally transcendental, peaceful. Sometimes he appears to be disturbed. Is it not? Hanuman will explain that in the upcoming verses. Unless one is saturated with love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one cannot appreciate the transcendental value of Lord Ramachandra. One cannot see him with material eyes because demons like Ravana have no spiritual vision. They consider Lord Ramachandra an ordinary Kshatriya king. Ravana therefore attempted to kidnap Lord Ramachandra's eternal consort Sita Devi. Actually, however, Ravana could not carry off Sita Devi in her original form. As soon as she was touched by Ravana's hands, she gave him a material form, but she maintained her original form beyond his vision. This is noted in Kurma Purana. Lord Ramachandra, he gathered some evidence to give to Ramdas Vipra in South India. This was recorded in Chaitanya Charitamrita. It is actually well known now that the Kurma Purana provides sufficient evidence for this. Therefore, in this verse, the words Pratyak Prashantam indicate that Lord Ramachandra and his potency, the goddess Sita, keep themselves aloof from the influence of the material energy. In the Upanishads, it is said, Yamme Vaishivrinukte Tenalabhya. The Supreme Lord Paramatma, the personality of Godhead, can be seen or perceived only by persons who are saturated with devotion souls. Literally, this Upanishad statement means he can be attained only by those whom he himself chooses. As stated in the Brahma Samhita, Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santas Sadaiva Hrudayeshu Vilokayanti Yam Shyama Sundaram Achintya Guna Swarupam Yam Shyama Sundaram Achintya Guna Swarupam Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the primeval Lord Govinda, who is always seen by the devotee, whose eyes are anointed with the pulp of love, he is seen in his eternal form of Shyamasundara, situated within the heart of the devotee. Similarly, in the Chantogya Upanishad, it is stated, Etastisro Devata Anena Jivena. In this verse of the Chandogya Upanishad, the word Anena is used to distinguish the Atma and Paramatma as two separate identities. This is a section dealing with creation in the Chandogya Upanishad. I will not present an explanation of that section. It is enough to note that this statement distinguishes the Jivatma and Paramatma. The words Tisro Devata indicate that the body of the living entity is made of three material elements, fire, earth, and water. Although the Paramatma enters the heart of the Jivatma, who is influenced and designated by a material body, the Paramatma has nothing to do with the Jivatma's body. Because the Paramatma has no material connections, he is described here as Anama Rupam Niraham. The Paramatma has no material identity, whereas the Jivatma does. The Jivatma may introduce himself as an Indian, American, German, and so on, but the Paramatma has no such material designations, and therefore he has no material name. The Jivatma is different from his name, but the Paramatma is not. His name and he himself are one and the same. This is the meaning of Niraham, which means without material designations. This word cannot possibly be twisted to mean that the Paramatma has no ahankar or no I-ness or identity. He has his transcendental identity as the Supreme. I-ness or identity means self-awareness. If you take any material element, for instance, I'm holding a mobile phone here. This mobile phone does not know that it is being held by me. The mobile phone doesn't even know that it is a mobile phone. It has no self-awareness. So that is what is called the sense of I or identity. So Lord Ramacandra, he has, because he is a supreme personality of Godhead, he does have an identity, just as we also have identities. Identity by itself is not a problem. It is a false conception of identity or a misconception of identity that is the problem. When I think that I am my current material body and the personality related to my current material body, then that is a problem. So the Jivatmas, they are capable of coming under such misconceptions. But the Supreme Personality of God, it never ever assumes a material body, and therefore he does not have a misconception at all. He has his transcendental identity as a Supreme. This is the explanation given by Srila Jiva Goswami. According to another interpretation given by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Niraham means Nirnshayena. Niraham does not mean that the Supreme Lord has no identity. Rather, the stress given by the word Aham proves strongly that he does have his personal identity. Because Nir not only means negative, but also means strong ascertainment. So in other words, the Supreme Personality of Godhead has an identity. Now why does Hanuman have to describe his beloved Lord Ram in such a philosophical manner like this? There is a misconception among some devotees that philosophy or philosophical realization is either material or it is bordering on the material platform. It is neither of the two. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he writes in his Tattva Sutra, one of his books, Vichara Ragau Chetana Dharmo Swarupa Pravrittitva. The pure living entity itself has two features. One is logical analysis, and the other is affection or love. Love is the activity of the living entity. The living entity wants to love, wants to be loved. The very nature of the living entity is to rationally comprehend things, to intelligently understand things. So these are actually directly the original spiritual features of the soul So therefore, we find throughout the Srimad-Bhagavatam, not just here, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is always described in a very rational, intellectual manner as being different from anything material. Very, very important to understand, because Srimad-Bhagavatam is a scripture which clarifies the nature of the Supreme Lord, and it is meant for the Paramahamsas who are capable of understanding that. The lower scriptures, the first of all, scriptures are stratified. There are higher scriptures which clarify the teachings of the lower scriptures. The lower scriptures need to be clarified. Lower scripture doesn't mean that it is bad or something like that. It is not like that. Just as the same learned person may write a textbook for the primary school student, and he may also write a textbook for a university, postgraduate university student. It is possible. So similarly, the Supreme Lord, he presents certain scriptures for people who are not very much spiritually awakened and mature. And he presents higher scriptures for those who are more advanced in their realization and understanding. So Srimad-Bhagavatam is the topmost scripture. So therefore, it takes great pains to describe the features of the Supreme Lord. So we should not try to forget this reality. Martyavatarastrikha martyashikshanam rakshovatha yaivana kevalam vibho kutonyatha syad ramatasva atmana sita krittani vyasanani vyasananishwarasya. It was ordained that Ravana, chief of the Rakshasas, could not be killed by anyone but a man. And for this reason, Lord Ramachandra, the Supreme Personality of God, had appeared in the form of a human being. Lord Ramachandra's mission, however, was not only to kill Ravana, but also to teach mortal beings that material happiness centered around sex life or centered around one's wife is the cause of many miseries. He is the self-sufficient Supreme Personality of Godhead, and nothing is lamentable for him. Therefore, why else could he be subjected to tribulations by the kidnapping of Mother Sita? Purport: when the Lord appears in this universe in the form of a human being, he has two purposes, as stated in Bhagavad Gita: Paritranaya Sadhunam, Vinashaya Chitushkritam, to destroy the demons and protect the devotees. So two purposes: one is to destroy the miscreants, and the other is to take care of the devotees. To protect the devotees, the Lord not only satisfies them by his personal presence, but also teaches them so that they will not fall down from devotional service. By his personal example, Lord Ramachandra taught the devotees that it is better not to enter married life, which is certainly followed by many tribulations. Tribulation. Prabhupada uses words like this. Tribulation. Tribulation means extreme difficulty. As confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam 7.9.45, Yan Maithunadi Grihamedi Sukham Hitucham Kandu Yanena Karayori Vadukha Dukham Tripyanti Neha Kripana Bahudukha Bhaja Kandu Tivan Manasijam Vishaheta Tihira. Kripanas, those who are not advanced in spiritual knowledge and who are therefore just the opposite of Brahmanas generally take to family life, which is a concession for sex. Thus they enjoy sex again and again, although that sex is followed by many tribulations. This is a warning to devotees. To teach this lesson to devotees and to human society in general, Lord Sri Ramachandra, although Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, underwent a series of tribulations because he accepted a wife, Mother Sita. Lord Ramachandra underwent these austerities, of course, only to instruct us. Actually, he never has any reason to lament for anything. In the third canto of Valmiki Ramayana, after Rama is separated from Sita Devi, we will come across Lord Rama exhibiting a lot of lamentation, exhibiting a lot of distress, sorrow. So that is to make us understand that when we become attached, even within the boundaries of Vedic Dharma, then we will only end up in distress. Another aspect of the Lord, so that is an instruction for the devotees. So, paritranaya sadhu nam, this is sadhu paritrana, happens by Lord Ram's personal demonstration, his teaching. See, this is what it is. So, those who are serious about liberation from material existence, they should keep away from all this. They should first of all keep away from adharma. And even within dharma, they should be very careful and function in the mode of goodness. That very point, Prabhupada points out in the next paragraph in the purport here. Another aspect of the Lord's instructions is that one who accepts a wife must be a faithful husband and give her full protection. Human society is divided into two classes of men. Those just a minute. Those who strictly follow the religious principles and those who are devotees. So there are two types. Those who strictly follow the religious principles. These are the karmis. And those who are devotees. Now, there are actually four categories of people noted by five categories, you can say. By Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, you have sinful people, sins enjoyers, vishayis, who just want to enjoy whatever they can in this life. Anyabhilashis, as Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to call them. Then you have the karmis, jnanis, yogis and bhaktas. The karmis are those who very strictly follow Vedic Dharma. They want to enjoy, but they want to enjoy in the next life. They don't want to enjoy anything in this life. This is actually a proper karmi. A proper karmi is interested in enjoying in the next life. Jnanis, yogis and bhaktas, they are interested in spiritual realization. By jnani, here we are referring to a nirvishesha brahman jnani, those interested in impersonal spiritual experience. One who wants to realize the effulgence of the spiritual body of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The yogi here refers to the Paramatma Upasaka, the one who meditates on Paramatma through Ashtanga Yoga system, Jnana Yoga. Then we have the bhaktas. The bhaktas are absorbed in exclusive devotional service, Navavidha Bhakti, to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So, there are those who are people interested in spiritual realization, and there are those who are interested in material enjoyment. By his personal example, Lord Ramachandra wanted to instruct both of them how to fully adopt the discipline of the religious system and how to be a beloved and dutiful husband. Otherwise, he had no reason to undergo apparent tribulations. One who strictly follows religious principles must not neglect to provide all facilities for the complete protection of his wife. There may be some suffering because of this, but one must nevertheless endure it. That is the duty of a faithful husband. By his personal example, Lord Ramachandra demonstrated this duty. Lord Ramachandra could have produced hundreds and thousands of Sitas from his pleasure energy. But just to show the duty of a faithful husband, he not only rescued Sita from the hands of Ravana, but also killed Ravana and all the members of his family. So this is the duty of if one is a Kshatriya, and if one is a husband, Kshatriyas are duty bound to marry, first of all. One cannot even be coronated if he doesn't have a wife. A Kshatriya wife, that also. So Lord Ramachandra, he demonstrated that when we follow dharma, we should follow dharma very, very carefully. This becomes very clear in the initial chapters of Ayodhya Kanda, the second canto of Valmiki Ramayana. Rama is as enthusiastic to go to the forest as he is to become the king. There is no change in his enthusiasm to carry out whatever his duty is. That is very much visible. And he maintains a very jovial spirit also. So that is a teaching for us, that when we have to carry out our material dharma. Material dharma is material service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Spiritual dharma is spiritual service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Both of them should be carried out in order to please the Supreme Lord, to make the Lord happy. So Lord Ramachandra demonstrated this. And he also carried out his duties in its meticulous detail. Another aspect of the teachings of Lord Ramachandra is that although Lord Vishnu, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and his devotees may apparently suffer from material tribulations, they have nothing to do with such tribulations. They are mukta purushas, liberated persons under all circumstances. It is therefore said in the Chaitanya Bhagavatam, Jata dekho Vaishnavir vyavahar duh nishchay janiho taha paramanandu sukh. A Vaishnava is always firmly situated in transcendental bliss because of engagement in devotional service. Although he may appear to suffer material pains, his position is called transcendental bliss in separation, viraha. The emotions a lover and beloved feel when separated from one another are actually very blissful, although apparently painful. Therefore, the separation of Lord Ramachandra from Sita Devi, as well as the consequent tribulation they suffered, is but another display of transcendental bliss. That is the opinion of Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Navaisa atma vatamsa prittama saktastrilokyam bhagavan vasudeva nastrikritam kashmalam mashnu vita na lakshmanam chapi vihatum arhati. Since Lord Sri Ramachandra is the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vasudeva, he is not attached to anything in this material world. He is the most beloved super soul of all self-realized souls, and he is their very intimate friend. He is full of all opulences. Therefore, he could not possibly have suffered because of separation from his wife, nor could he have given up his wife and Lakshmana, his younger brother. To give up either would have been absolutely impossible. In defining the Supreme Personality of Godhead, we say that he is full in all six opulences: wealth, fame, strength, influence, beauty, and renunciation. He is called renounced because he is not attached to anything in this material world. He is specifically attached to the spiritual world and the living entities there. The affairs of the material world take place under the superintendence of Durga Devi. Srishti sthiti pralaya sadhana shaktireka chayeva yasya bhuvanani vibhakti Durga. Everything is going on under the strict rules and regulations of the material energy represented by Durga. Therefore, the Lord is completely detached and need not give attention to the material world. Sita Devi belongs to the spiritual world. So this explains why Lord Rama is actually attached to Mother Sita. This is not a material attraction. It is not the attraction of a husband to a wife, as it is experienced in the material world. Similarly, Lord Lakshmana, Ramachandra's younger brother, is a manifestation of Sankarsana, and Lord Ramachandra himself is Vasudeva, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Since the Lord is always spiritually qualified, he is attached to servants who always render transcendental loving service unto him. He is attached to the truth in life, not to Brahmanical qualities. Indeed, he is never attached to any material quality. Although he is a super soul of all living entities, he is specifically manifest to those who are self-realized, and he is especially dear to the hearts of his transcendental devotees. So Lord Ram, he is the super soul, he is the source of the impersonal Brahman also, is Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is manifest to those who are self-realized. He is not manifest to those who are not self-realized. He is especially dear to the devotees, meaning those who are Prema Bhaktas, those who have pure love for him. Because Lord Ramachandra descended to teach human society how beautiful a king should be, he apparently gave up the company of Mother Sita and Lakshman. Factually, however, he could not have given them up. So this is Hanuman's explanation on why Lord Rama, he gave up Mother Sita. There's a lot behind this incident, but one aspect of it is brought out by Hanuman here, that this is just to teach human society that one who takes the role of leadership, one who takes the role of leading a community, leading a country, leading a nation, he should not become emotionally attached to anyone whom he likes. He should be willing to sacrifice that for everyone. That is one particular lesson that we can learn from this. If you go through Valmiki Ramayana with a parampara explanation, then you understand further why this happened. One should therefore learn about the activities of Lord Ramachandra from a self-realized soul. Then one can understand the transcendental activities of the Lord. Na janma nunam mahato na saubhagam na vang na buddhir na kritis tosha hetupu tair yad visrishtan api no vanau kasash chakara sakye bata lakshman agraja. One cannot establish a friendship with the Supreme Lord Ramachandra on the basis of material qualities such as one's birth in an aristocratic family, one's personal beauty, one's eloquence, one's supreme intelligence, or one's superior race or nation. None of these qualifications is actually a prerequisite for friendship with Lord Sri Ramachandra. Otherwise, how is it possible that although we uncivilized inhabitants of the forest have not taken noble birds, although we have no physical beauty, and although we cannot speak like gentlemen, Lord Ramachandra has nevertheless accepted as friends? Hanuman here, of course, is exhibiting his natural humility. He himself is an exceptionally powerful scholar, exceptionally intelligent. These features of Hanuman become very clear in the Ramayana, Valmiki Ramayana. But nevertheless, he is considering himself to be just like any vanara. And he's pointing out that Lord Ram, he's very kind to everyone. In a prayer to Krishna expressing her feelings, Srimati Kunti Devi called him Akinchana Gochara. The prefix A means not, and Kinchana, something of his material world. One may be very proud of his prestigious position, material wealth, beauty, education, and so on. But although these are certainly good qualifications in material dealings, they are not necessary for achieving friendship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One who possesses all these material qualities is expected to become a devotee. And when he actually does, the qualities are properly utilized. Otherwise, these qualities are improperly utilized. Those who are puffed up by a high birth, wealth, education, and personal beauty, Janmaishwari, Shruta, Shri, unfortunately do not care for developing Krishna consciousness. Nor does the Supreme Personality of Godhead care about all these material qualifications. So Lord Krishna or Lord Ram does not bother about these material qualifications. He's bothered about the purity of our devotional service. The Supreme Lord is achieved by devotion. Bhaktyamam avijanati. One's devotion and sincere desire to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead are the only qualifications. Sincere desire. Non-duplicitous desire. These are the only qualifications. Rupa Goswami has also said that the price for achieving God's favor is simply one's sincere eagerness to have it. Laulyam ekam mulyam. It's only one price. For everything there is a price. This is a reference to a verse in the Bhaktira Samrita Sindhu. And in Prabhupada's summary study of Bhaktira Samrita Sindhu, the nectar of devotion, Prabhupada points out that everything has a value, everything has a price. You need to pay the price to get it. So what is the price for attaining the favor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? It is one's eagerness. And according to, just like a rich person can go to a shop and a not so rich person can go to the same shop. One who has more money will be able to purchase more, and one who has less money will be able to purchase less. So like that, the purity of one's devotion service is exhibited in the form of one's non-duplicitous eagerness to selflessly satisfy the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, or his personal expansions. That is the price. To whatever degree I have that, to that degree I will be able to attain the Supreme Lord's mercy. We always talk about yasya prasadan bhagavat prasadam, yasya prasadan nagatih kutu. But we should also consider whether we are receiving the favor of the Supreme Lord. The favor of the Supreme Lord is the help that we receive to progress from Shraddha to Prema. So when we do satisfy Him, we will progress. And there are symptoms with which we can understand whether we are progressing or not. Just as we can understand whether our hunger is decreasing. So like that, there are symptoms by which we can understand whether our lust, anger, greed are decreasing, or whether they are increasing, or whether they are stagnant at the same, whether they are at the same level, neither increasing nor decreasing. We can understand that. So anarthanivritti is a proof of achievement of Krishna's favor upon us. And for that we need to pay. It is not just going to fall from the sky. And it is not that if I just keep doing whatever I do over a period of time, everything will happen. It will not happen. No. Just you may be a customer in a shop for 10 years, but if you have not become richer and richer and richer, and you're not purchasing more and more and more, it is not expected that you'll buy more and more products from that shop. If your wealth remains the same, then you'll only purchase products up to that within that financial capacity of yours, which hasn't increased. So this is the price that we need to pay for it. In the Chaitanya Bhagavata, it is said, Khola vecha seva kir dekho bhagya sima, brahma shiva kande jar dekhiya mohima, dhane jane panditye krishna nahi pai, kebol bhaktir vas chaitanya gosai. Behold the good fortune of the devotee Khola vecha. Lord Brahma and Shiva shed tears upon seeing his greatness. One cannot attain Lord Krishna by any amount of wealth, followers or learning. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is controlled only by pure devotion. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had a very sincere devotee whose name was Kolavecha Sridhar, and whose only business was to sell pots made of the skin of banana trees. Whatever income he had, he used 50% for the worship of Mother Ganges. And with the other 50%, he provided for his necessities. So you see the 50% principle that is coming here. This, and there are several other examples also of people utilizing 50% of their income directly in the service of the Supreme Personality of God. On the whole, he was so very poor that he lived in a cottage that had a broken roof with many holes in it. He could not afford brass utensils, and therefore he drank water from an iron pot. Nevertheless, he was a great devotee of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He is a typical example of how a poor man with no material possessions can become a most exalted devotee of the Lord. The conclusion is that one cannot attain shelter at the lotus feet of Lord Krishna or Sri Chaitanya Gosai through material opulence. That shelter is attainable only by pure devotional service. We have devotional service and we have pure devotional service. my teacher Sri Gopi Purandan Prabhu, he once told me that the preaching mission of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu involves three stages. The first stage is to make non-devotees into devotees, and the relevant textbook for that is Bhagavad Gita. The second stage is to help devotees become pure devotees. And the relevant textbook for that is Srimad-Bhagavatam. The third stage is to help pure devotees become perfect pure devotees of the Supreme Lord. And the relevant book for that is Chaitanya Charitamrita. So I often refer to this as level 1, level 2 and level 3. Just as most of the devotees that we preach to don't become practicing devotees, they don't take initiation, become devotees. Like that, most of the devotees will not become pure devotees. They will not enter level 2. Only some will enter level 2. And those amongst those who have come to level 2 also, most of them will be stuck there. And only some of them will progress towards perfect pure devotional service, prema bhakti, love of God. This is to be expected. And of course, a Vaishnava wants everyone to come to that point. That is the natural spiritual desire of the Supreme Lord and those who are perfect pure devotees. They want everyone to come to that point. Because as we make spiritual progress, we also understand how easy it is. The more we progress, the more we realize how easy it is, actually. So that pure devotional service unto the Supreme Lord, that what it refers to is set out by Rupa Goswami in his definition. Anyabhilashita shunyam janakarma janavritam anukulyena krishna anushilanam nuktiruttama. One should render transcendental loving service to the Supreme Lord Krishna favorably, without desire for material profit or gain through fruitive activities or philosophical speculation. That is called pure devotional service. As we read Prabhupada's books and we engage in service to Lord Krishna according to the teachings found in his books, then we'll be able to understand the nature of pure devotional service better and better. Suro va. Yatha vanaro narai sarvatmana yastu kritajyam uttamam bhajeta rama manajakritam harim yat uttaranayat kosalam divam iti. Therefore, whether one is a demigod or a demon, a man or a creature other than man, such as a beast or bird, everyone should worship Lord Ramachandra, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who appears on this earth just like a human being. There is no need of great austerities or penances to worship the Lord, for he accepts even a small service offered by his devotee. Thus he is satisfied, and as soon as he is satisfied, the devotee is successful. Indeed, Lord Sri Ramachandra brought all the devotees of Ayodhya back home, back to Godhead, Vaikuntha. The followers of Sri Ramanujacharya, they are very fond of Valmiki Ramayana. And they consider the Valmiki Ramayana itself to be an elaborate explanation of the process of surrender unto the Supreme Lord, Sharanagati. Sharanagati itself has a technical meaning. Anukulyasya sankalpa, pratikulyasya varjanam, prakshishyati iti vishwasa, vaktritve varanam tatha, Atmanikshepa karpanye shadvidha sharanagati. There are six items to surrendering unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and all six items are essential. Unless one engages in the six items of surrender to the Supreme Lord, he is not considered to be a faithful devotee of the Supreme Lord up to the standard of pure devotional service. Bhaktivinoda Thakur has said, Sharanga Sharanagati Hai Bejahar Tar Prarthana Shune Shri Nanda Kumar. Lord Krishna, the son of Nanda Maharaj, he listens to the prayers offered by devotees who engage in all these six items of surrender. The first item of surrender is to do those activities which are pleasing to the Supreme Lord. Anukulyasya sankalpa. The second item is to give up those activities which are displeasing to the Supreme Lord. Pratikulyasya varjana. The third item is to maintain confidence that by doing these two, when I do these two, then the Supreme Lord will take care of me. He will provide for me. Rakshishyati iti vishwasa. This is called Mahavishwasa. These six items are explained in detail in the Pancharatrika scriptures. Ahirbhutinya Samhita, Bharatvaja Samhita, some other places also. It is brought out in detail in the Pancharatrika scriptures. So those who are interested in surrendering unto the Supreme Lord by following these six guidelines, they are generally happy to discover or learn any amount of scriptural instruction on them. So this third item is the conviction that the Supreme Lord will protect me. Protect me means that he will give me yogakshema. He will give me what I require and he will preserve what he has already given me. He will ensure that I don't lose it. Rakshishyati iti vishwasa. Goptritve varanam tatha. This is the fourth item. The fourth item is one should seek the shelter of the Supreme Lord. It is not enough that if I do these three items, it is not enough. One of the items of surrender is that we must pray to the Supreme Lord. We must tell him, please help me. One should ask for his protection. This is very important. This establishes that we are subordinate and that he is superordinate. It makes it very clear. It establishes our sambandha, our relationship, that he is our master and that we are his dependent servants. Sotritpe varanam tatha atmanikshepa. One must completely give oneself unto him. This is also called atmaniveda. Atmanikshepa karpanye. This refers to dainya or a constant state of humility. At the very least, no matter how egoistic we are with other devotees and so on, at least we should maintain enough humility with the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. At least that much. That is the starting point. Therefore, in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's presentation of the six items of surrender, in his book called Sharanagati, we first of all find dainya. First of all, you need to be humble. Then comes atmanivedana. Then we surrender unto the Supreme Lord. Dainya atmanivedana gotritvayavaran. Then we pray to the Supreme Lord to protect us. We have to accept him as our protector. Avashya rakshave Krishna vishwaspalam. One should maintain the great conviction that Krishna will take care of me. He knows, he is there to take care of me. Bhaktyanukul matra karjasvikar bhaktir pratikul bhav vajanagikar. And we should accept anything that is favorable for progressing in bhakti from shraddha to prema and reject anything which does not help us progress. So these are six items of surrender unto the Supreme Lord. And Sri Valmiki in Valmiki Ramayana, he points out these six items. But in Bhagavatam, these things are brought out very explicitly. Lord Sri Ramachandra is so kind and merciful to his devotees that he is very easily satisfied by a little service rendered by anyone, human or not. This is the special advantage of worshipping Lord Ramachandra, and there is the special advantage in, and there is the same advantage in worshipping Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Lord Krishna and Lord Ramachandra, in the manner of Kshatriyas, sometimes showed their mercy by killing asuras, but Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu awarded love of God without difficulty, even to the asuras. When the asuras surrendered unto Lord Chaitanya, then he showed them mercy. All the incarnations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but especially Lord Ramachandra, Lord Krishna, and later Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, delivered many of the living entities present before them. Indeed, almost all of them. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is therefore represented in the six-armed form of Shadbhuja Murti, which is a combination of Lord Ramachandra, Lord Krishna, and Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The best purpose of human life can be fulfilled by worshipping the Shadbhuja Murti, the form of the Lord with six arms, two arms of Ramachandra, two arms of Krishna, and two arms of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When we worship Lord Krishna, we should be careful that we do not imitate Lord Krishna. Because Krishna engages in various activities, and if we try to imitate him, it will backfire. They will backfire. Whereas Ramachandra, most of his activities are meant to help us follow Vedic Dharma in such a manner that we progress in devotion service unto the Supreme Lord. We commonly understand that Lord Rama, he demonstrates Dharma. He is a very personification of Dharma, in fact. This is something that even Maricha, he understands. Rama is the very personification of Vedic Dharma. What kind of Dharma? That kind of Dharma which is executed in the mode of goodness. One can execute Dharma in order to attain material happiness. Or one can execute Dharma in order to attain freedom from lust, anger, greed. The three primary anarthas. Everything in Vedic Dharma is presented for this purpose actually. This is the internal purpose. The external purpose is to give us material happiness and so on. Take for instance, the arrangement for Garhastya, Grihastha. Why is it presented? You can say it is presented because most of the conditioned souls are having various material desires, and the Grihastha Ashrama is a concessional allowance. It's a license presented for them to satisfy themselves within Vedic Dharma. That is true in one aspect. But in another aspect, it is presented actually as a means to become fully purified. In the similar manner, all the duties of all the ashrams, not just Garhastha, Brahmacharya, Vanaprastha, Sannyas, the duties of the four Varnas, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Varna Dharma, Ashrama Dharma are meant for men. And for women, there is three dharma, which Sita Devi demonstrates. And why she has to do that? Because for the woman also, for them to become purified from lust, anger, greed, they need to follow Sri Dharma. So the Supreme Lord, he demonstrates all this. And he's exceptionally kind in the form of Lord Ram. He's exceptionally kind to everyone who surrenders unto him. Even a subhuman creature can surrender unto the Supreme Lord, and the Supreme Lord takes care of him. This is a special feature of Lord Ram. We notice this feature amongst in Lord Krishna and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also. Even more so in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, on this sacred day of Ram Navami, we can pray to Lord Ramachandra. Dharma vigrahavan adharma viratim dhanvi satanvitara. May this personification of Vedic Dharma, Lord Rama, the great archer, may he give us a distaste for adharma. In that way, we can make tangible progress in Krishna consciousness. And everyone, whether a karmi or a jnani or a yogi or a bhakta, whoever you take, cannot engage in the activities of adharma. Adharma has nothing to do with anyone who wants to take advantage of Vedic Dharma. And the highest form of Vedic Dharma is the process of bhakti. And one cannot engage in the highest of the high and the lowest of the low at the same time. These aspects are very plainly demonstrated by Lord Ramachandra. Just as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu demonstrates Bhagavata Dharma, spiritual Dharma. Similarly, Lord Ramachandra demonstrates, Lord Ramachandra and his associates, they demonstrate material Dharma. For those of us who are incapable of exclusively engaging in spiritual Dharma, like a sannyasi, like a pure Vaishnava sannyasi, we need to engage in, we need to give up a dharma and engage in our activities of material dharma, which itself should be mixed with Bhagavad Bhakti. While we take care of our families and so on, we should mix those activities with devotional service unto the Supreme Lord, and we should dedicate some exclusive time every day in order to exclusively engage in spiritual dharma. Then over time, we should try to increase that, increase, until we come to the point where we lose the taste for dharma, we lose the taste for material dharma also. So while we are going through this, just as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates, they set an example of how to engage in spiritual dharma. So like that, Lord Ramachandra and his associates, they give an example how to engage in material dharma. Material dharma, you can say, is like an infrastructure. But for those of us who are incapable of exclusively engaging in spiritual dharma, without pursuing anything material, we require to engage in the activities of material dharma too, but in the mode of goodness and by mixing it with devotional service and the Supreme Lord, with Krishna consciousness, with a consciousness of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But nevertheless, we need to know how to do it. And Lord Ram and his associates, they demonstrate that very well. I will also take this opportunity to point out that since Prabhupada very much wanted to present an edition of Valmiki Ramayana, I am part of a team. I am one of the members, one of the contributors of a team working on a translated version of Valmiki Ramayana. The first canto of Balakanda was released by Srila Jayapataka Swami Maharaj last year. And this year, because of the lockdown, we have been experiencing some difficulties. The printer hasn't printed any, we don't have the five volumes of the second canto, Ayodhya Kanda yet. I will request anyone who's interested in understanding Ramayana in accordance with the teachings of Bhagavad Gita, Srimad-Bhagavatam, as presented by the Vaishnava Acharyas, as explained by Prabhupada, to consider getting these and reading them. A digital version of the first canto will be put up by Narasimha Chaturdashi, and we will notify the world about it. It will be like Vani source. It will have everything, the text, the entire text will be there. But the books are so important that I do think that serious readers should actually get and read. The version has Sanskrit text translated. It's exactly as how Prabhupada wanted it. We have been trying to follow that. There'll be a canto summary based on a summary of the Ramayana produced in the Madhva line. Then, of course, the text transliteration, synonyms, translation. We have presented an abridged rendition of the Ramanuja line's standard commentary, Ramayana. From the second canto onwards, we have portions of a commentary available in print from the Madhva line, classical commentary, and an abridged edition of that is also coming. Then we have also included quotations from our own acharyas from the Gaudiya Vaishnava line, as well as quotations from Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam with Prabhupada's explanation wherever required. So this is there for those who are more interested in understanding Lord Ramachandra's activities as they have been revealed in the Valmiki Ramayana. I will also be beginning a podcast on Ramayana starting tomorrow, Mondays, Wednesdays, Fridays, a 10-minute audio where I'll be going through this in sequence. Ramakathamrita. I'll have a link put up in the WhatsApp group, so those who are interested can join. This will be through a Telegram broadcast. Okay, thank you for listening. I'm going to now have a look if there are any questions. Let me first of all stop the share. Okay, there are a number of where did you read that from regarding the soul, regarding at the end of text 4? What did I read from the end of text 4? Let's see. About the Jivatma and Paramatma. This is from the Chandogya Upanishad, this portion. All right, thank you very much for listening. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Just take this opportunity to remember the teachings of Lord Ram as demonstrated by him in Sri Ramayana. Jai Sri Ram. Okay, close this. Okay, I'm going to end the meeting. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.